From New York, this is Democracy Now!
Just had an election, the second largest national election in the world in terms of voter participation. The loser in that election, General Prabowo, the country's most notorious mass killer, longtime protege of the U.S., refuses to accept the results. He sent his people out on to the streets. They're rioting.
As deadly post-elections rock Indonesia, we speak to investigative journalist Alan Nairn, then to the Indian elections.
A terrible time for democracy in India and in the world. The Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who has just completed a five-year term, has been re-elected with an absolute majority again for another 5 years, which means that it is going to be unending violence against minorities, against the poor, against farmers, and against the environment.
Then to Syria. Amnesty International calls for the United States to pay reparations to survivors of the U.S.-led coalition attack on Raqqa that killed more than 1,600 civilians.
My children, my husband, my mother, my sister, my niece, my whole family. I've lost them all, my dearest ones. We were sitting in the basement when the rocket hit just before sunset. When it hit, my face was burnt by the flames.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The Trump administration admitted Wednesday a 10-year-old girl from El Salvador died in the custody of Department of Health and Human Services last September, making her at least the sixth child to die in recent months after crossing into the United States from Mexico. The Office of Refugee Resettlement described the girl, who was not named, as medically fragile, said she died of fever and respiratory distress in an Omaha, Nebraska hospital. Wednesday's disclosure drew protests from Democratic lawmakers who accused the Trump administration of covering up the death for 8 months. Five other children, all of them from Guatemala, have died in U.S. custody or shortly after being released over the last 8 months. Before last year, no child died in immigration custody in over a decade. On Wednesday, lawmakers on the House Homeland Security Committee grilled acting DHS Secretary Kevin McAleenan about the deaths. This is Illinois freshman Democratic Congressmember Lauren Underwood.
At this point, with five kids that have died, 5,000 separated from their families, I feel like—and the evidence is really clear—that this is intentional. It's intentional. It's a policy choice being made on purpose by this administration, and it's cruel and inhumane. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
That's an appalling accusation, and our men and women fight hard to protect people in our custody every single day.
After that exchange, Republicans on the Homeland Security Committee led a vote to admonish Congressmember Underwood, had her statement stricken from the record, and barred her from talking during the remainder of the session. In New York City, a federal judge ruled Wednesday Deutsche Bank and Capital One must turn over financial documents subpoenaed by Congress as lawmakers investigate whether Trump's business ties are influencing White House policy. Deutsche Bank loaned over $2 billion to Trump for real estate deals over nearly two decades, even when other banks refused to do so. The decision came 2 days after a D.C. district judge upheld a subpoena ordering Trump's accounting firm to hand over 10 years of Trump's financial records. Meanwhile, New York lawmakers approved a bill Wednesday that would give Congress access to President Trump's state tax returns. This is New York Assemblymember Barbara Lifton.
They are deeply concerned, as am I, that our democracy is being undermined on a daily basis by the current administration. And the power of Congress to provide proper and constitutional oversight of the executive branch is being abrogated to an unprecedented degree.
President Trump stormed out of a White House meeting Wednesday with House Speaker Nancy Pelosi and Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer, saying he won't work with Democratic leaders until they end what he called phony inquiries into his presidency. Trump's outburst came just hours after Pelosi accused him of engaging in a cover-up by resisting congressional subpoenas.
We believe that no one is above the law, including the President of the United States, and we believe that the President of the United States is engaged in a cover-up.
Trump cited Pelosi's comment as his reason for storming out of Wednesday's meeting. He spoke to reporters in the White House Rose Garden just after the confrontation.
I don't do cover-ups. You people know that probably better than anybody.
Trump's outburst ended discussions with Pelosi and Schumer on a $2 trillion plan to reinvest in U.S. infrastructure. After the aborted meeting, Senator Schumer said Trump had clearly planned the move in advance.
It's clear that this was not a spontaneous move on the president's part. It was planned. When we got in the room, the curtains were closed. The president, there was a place for him at the front so he could stand and attempt to tell us why he wouldn't do infrastructure. And, of course, then he went to the Rose Garden with prepared signs that had been printed up long before our meeting.
Meanwhile, House Speaker Pelosi's staff held a caucus meeting Wednesday to tamp down demands by many Democrats to open impeachment proceedings against Donald Trump. Pentagon officials are preparing to deploy up to 10,000 more troops to the Middle East as President Trump and his top foreign policy advisors continue to threaten war with Iran. The AP reports the Pentagon will brief the White House today on a plan that also requests more U.S. ships, missile batteries, and increased efforts to spy on Iran. In India, Prime Minister Narendra Modi is poised to enter a second five-year term after election results show him winning a six-week-long parliamentary election that was widely seen as a referendum on his leadership. Election results so far, Modi's Hindu nationalist BJP party leading in 300 of the 543 seats in parliament. If the trend holds, Modi will have an even greater majority than in 2014, when his party claimed the first outright majority in decades. We'll have more on Modi's apparent election victory in India later in the broadcast. In Missouri, severe storms tore through the capital, Jefferson City, overnight, spawning tornadoes that flattened buildings and damaged the state capitol building. Authorities reported at least three storm-related deaths across Missouri Wednesday. Meanwhile, there are forecasts for record-breaking high temperatures in the southeast, with highs of over 100 degrees Fahrenheit possible in an area stretching from Virginia to Alabama. The extreme weather is consistent with models of climate change. John Walker Lynn, the American captured in Afghanistan in 2001 and convicted of serving the Taliban, is set to be released from an Indiana prison today after spending 17 years behind bars. Known as the American Taliban, Lynn converted to Islam at the age of 16 in California and ended up in Afghanistan, where he fought with the Taliban-run Afghan army against the Northern Alliance in Afghanistan's civil war. He was captured in late 2001 after being found emaciated and wounded as one of the few to survive a massacre by the Northern Alliance. He was then handed to U.S. forces, but they brutalized him as well. Former Pentagon chief Donald Rumsfeld had ordered them to take the gloves off. When John returned to the United States in January 2002, he was being held as a prisoner accused of conspiring to kill Americans. As part of a plea deal, Lynn pleaded guilty to serving in the Taliban army and carrying weapons and was given a 20-year sentence. And Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin said Wednesday plans to replace Andrew Jackson's portrait on the $20 bill with abolitionist leader, former slave Harriet Tubman, are on hold until at least 2026. Tubman would be the first woman in over a century and the first African-American to appear on a U.S. banknote. This is Massachusetts Democrat, freshman Congressmember Ayanna Pressley questioning Mnuchin on Wednesday.
The American people understood the importance of representation on the banknotes of the world's most powerful economy. Do you support Harriet Tubman being on the $20 bill?
I've made no decision as it relates to that, and that decision won't be made, as I said,
but there was a community process. There was a national—there was a community process.
Again, it's a decision of the Secretary of the Treasury. Right now, my decision is focused on security features.
President Trump has cited Andrew Jackson as his favorite U.S. president. Jackson was a slaveholder who, in 1830, signed the Indian Removal Act, which forced 16,000 Native Americans from their lands in what became known as the Trail of Tears. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Nermeen Sheikh. Welcome to our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. We begin today's show in Indonesia, where at least six people have died and hundreds have been injured after supporters of former military commander Prabowo Subianto took to the streets to protest his election defeat. The protest began after authorities announced President Joko Widodo, who's known as Jokowi, has won re-election after receiving 55% of the vote. Prabowo has refused to concede and is preparing to challenge the results.
Indonesian authorities have also arrested three backers of Prabowo for allegedly plotting to seize government buildings in Jakarta. One of the men arrested was Sunarko, the U.S.-trained former commander of Indonesia's special forces. We're joined now by longtime investigative journalist Alan Nairn, who recently returned from Indonesia. He's winner of the George Polk Award and a recipient of the Robert F. Kennedy Memorial Award. He's reported on Indonesia for the past three decades. Welcome back to Democracy Now, Alan. Talk about the significance of these elections and what has happened now with these deadly protests.
Well, in a sense, this election was a turning point for Indonesia, because if General Prabowo had won, it would have opened the door to a return to a kind of neo-fascism in Indonesia, a return to the ways of the old Suharto dictatorship. Prabowo is the most notorious mass killer in Indonesia. He's been implicated in mass killings in East Timor, Papua, Aceh, the kidnapping and torture of activists in Jakarta. He was also the closest U.S. protege in Indonesia, working directly for the U.S. Defense Intelligence Agency and U.S. Special Forces, repeatedly bringing U.S. Special Forces into Indonesia, where, among other things, they did reconnaissance for, as Prabowo told me, U.S. contingency planning for an invasion of Indonesia, if the U.S. ever decided to do that. Years ago, when Prabowo mused to me, when we had a conversation about the possibility of him seizing power and becoming what he called a fascist dictator. So his defeat is something of a turning point. It's the second time he has been defeated by Jokowi, the incumbent president. But he refuses to accept that defeat. He has, in effect, proclaimed himself the president. And now his backers, who include Islamist organizations, including a group called the FBI, and even elements of ISIS, have been out on the street trying to provoke an emergency which would require army intervention to take over the country and place Prabowo in power. The tactics they've used are reminiscent of tactics that were used by Prabowo and other forces when his father-in-law, the dictator Suharto, the U.S.-backed dictator, was falling, was being overthrown by a popular uprising in 98. In May of 98, they staged an operation against the local Chinese population, burning, looting, creating chaos. Also similar to tactics used in 1999 in East Timor, where the Indonesian military, including General Sunarko, who you just mentioned, used militias to stage arson, do killings, create chaos in East Timor after the Timorese voted for independence in a UN-sponsored referendum. And it also is a kind of a rerun of an attempted coup, which forces connected to Prabowo tried to stage in late 2016, early 2017, in what was known in Indonesia as the 212 movement, where they aligned with an Islamist street movement, which actually got broad popular support from conservative elements of the Islamist movement in Indonesia. And as military people at the time described it to me, their hope was to go in and actually take over, physically take over the Congress, physically occupy the palace and seize power. They failed at that time. Prabowo tried again this time after losing the election, but it looks like he doesn't have enough people on the streets. The deeper conflict that's happening is the old U.S.-trained generals versus democracy. There's Prabowo, who's trying to overturn an election result, but there are also key generals who are on the side of the winner of the election, President Jokowi, namely Generals Hendro Priyono and Wiranto, who are themselves mass killers, who've been involved in crimes like the 99 Timor massacres, the assassination of Munir, the leading human rights advocate, the Talangsadi massacre. They have been trying to do arrests of political dissidents and basically trying to crush free speech in Indonesia. So democracy is under siege from both sides of the partisan political spectrum by U.S.-trained generals, some of them working in alliance with these Islamist street organizations, a number of which were originally launched and created by the Indonesian army.
And can you talk about, Alan, what's Jokowi's record been in office?
Well, one of his promises when he first ran and defeated Prabowo in 2014 was that he would investigate the major atrocities, the major crimes, including the 1965 slaughter of up to a million civilians, which was backed by the United States and which enabled the Indonesian army to consolidate power. And he suggested, he heavily implied that he would put the generals on trial. He didn't do that. In fact, he brought two of the most notorious generals, Hendro and Wiranto, into his circle and his government because he's afraid of the army. Jokowi is afraid of the army. He hasn't really shown the courage so far to confront them and put them on trial. And he doesn't really have control of the army, but he has hoped that by allying with figures like these, he could maintain control. Now that he's in for a second term, I think there will be a popular demand that Jokowi live up to his old promises and put the generals on trial, including Hendro, Wiranto, Prabowo for his massacre crimes. And in my opinion, they should also try to try the U.S. officials who sponsored these generals, do like the Italians did when they put CIA agents on trial for a kidnapping in Rome. They can request the U.S. documents on these past atrocities backed by Washington. The U.S. Congress actually wrote a provision into the Foreign Operations Appropriations Bill, which provides for the U.S. turning over documents to Indonesia in the event that there are investigations and prosecutions. But this can only happen if there's a popular movement to put pressure on President Jokowi and if the forces of General Prabowo, who are essentially trying to seize power by violence, if they are finally defeated.
You had an expose just before Prabowo was defeated that could have weighed in there. Explain what you learned.
I published the minutes of a meeting that Prabowo held with his top generals and political confidants, where they laid out their plan in the event that he won the election and took power. And their plan was for mass arrests of political opponents, as you might expect, given Prabowo's politics, but also for mass arrests of many of his supporters, many of the leaders of these Islamist organizations who were the grassroots organizational core of his campaign and who are now many of those who are out in the streets throwing Molotov cocktails on Prabowo's behalf. And an interesting aspect was that in this meeting, they said that they were planning to do these mass arrests of their own allies in order to please the U.S. They talked about a meeting Prabowo had held with the U.S. Ambassador Donovan, and essentially to curry favor with the U.S., trying to get back into their good graces, rekindle the old alliance. They were planning to arrest not just opponents, but also allies, to consolidate sole power in Prabowo's hands. And after the peace came out, it seemed to have caused some disruption among the ranks of the Islamist groups and perhaps diminished their mobilization for him on Election Day and also in these past 2 days on the streets.
We're about to talk about the Indian elections. And the Indonesian elections are massive. Talk about the numbers and compare it to the United States.
They're really the second largest elections in the world. The largest is India by far. The second is Indonesia in terms of numbers of participants. In fact, although Indonesia is the fourth largest country in the world in terms of population, it's somewhat smaller than the U.S. But the election participation far outstrips that of the U.S. Jokowi and Prabowo each got many millions of more votes than Hillary Clinton and Trump respectively got in the recent U.S. election. Voter participation is about 80% in Indonesia. Plus, on top of that, you have a group of people who abstained from the election. It's called the Golput movement on principled grounds because they were disappointed with Jokowi failing to prosecute the generals. If in the U.S., we had that level of voter participation, the political landscape would be entirely different. I think the extremist Republicans in Trump in the U.S. would be swept from power if the U.S. participation went up from 65%, the current rate, to the Indonesian rate of 80%.
Just before you leave, can you weigh in on the whole impeachment debate in the United States?
Well, it's a longer discussion, but if you turn on, you know, CNN, MSNBC these days, unless you're someone who has been following these channels avidly, I think you'll find a lot of what they're talking about is incomprehensible gobbledygook, because they go on and on about Don McGahn and all these figures who most people don't know who they are, rather than talking about the substantive issues of the atrocities that Trump is committing daily, the abduction and, as you just mentioned, de facto murder of children on the border. The gutting of labor rights, the gutting of environmental protections, and instead they're talking about the Democrats are going off on a tangent, and they're handing Trump a political gift. If you're going to impeach him on substance, not a Russia plot, which Mueller already concluded Trump didn't criminally participate in.
Well, we're going to have to leave it there, because I know you have to catch a train, but I do want to ask you, on other grounds, that's what a number of the Democrats are talking about now. For example, not being willing to cooperate with Congress on giving over information.
Yeah, one problem, though, is the Democrats are creating this constitutional confrontation. They rightly point out that it's outrageous that Trump is not—is refusing to turn over documents that Congress has legally and rightfully subpoenaed. But Democrats are doing that premised on what is a very weak premise, the idea that somehow there's something nefarious in the Russia plot, when Mueller has already concluded that there was nothing there criminally. Do that based on substance. Do it based on his refusal to turn over documents about the crimes he's committing along the Mexican border, about the way he's driving the world to possible extinction through his stance on global warming, about his lifting of restrictions on the killing of civilians with the U.S. bombing and droning operations in the Middle East and North Africa. Do it on real issues, not a premise that is already been undercut by the Mueller investigation.
Alan Nairn, award-winning investigative journalist. When we come back, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi appears set to enter a second term in a landslide victory following a six-week parliamentary election. What does this mean for the future of democracy in India? Stay with us.
I'm just an American boy, raised on MTV. I seen all them kids and soda pop ads, none of them look like me. So I started looking around for light out of the dim. First thing I heard that made sense was the word of Muhammad, peace be upon him. How should I do? There's no God but God, if my daddy could see me now. It's changed around my feet. You don't understand. Sometimes a man got to fight for what he believes. I believe God is great. Up to the sky like Jesus, peace be upon him. How should I do? La ilaha illallah. There's no God but God.
Steve Earle singing John Walker's Blues in our studio in 2011. The song's about John Walker Lynn, who's being released from prison today after 17 years in jail. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
We turn now to India, where Prime Minister Narendra Modi appears set to enter a second term in a landslide victory following a six-week-long parliamentary election that was widely seen as a referendum on his leadership. Election results show Modi's Hindu nationalist BJP party leading in 300 of the 543 seats in parliament. At this rate, these numbers will give him an even greater majority than in 2014, when his party claimed the first outright majority in decades. Modi declared victory on Thursday, tweeting, quote, "Together we grow, together we prosper, together we will build a strong and inclusive India. India wins yet again," he tweeted. Voter turnout was a record 66%, with more than half a billion votes cast. India is the world's largest democracy, with 900 million eligible voters.
Most analysts had predicted Modi's BJP party would lose seats in this election because some of his economic policies. Modi's government's been criticized for a crackdown on civil society, targeting political opponents, journalists, human rights activists, lawyers and writers. Human rights groups have also raised the alarm on attacks against vulnerable populations, especially Dalits and Muslims. This comes as Modi's main opponent, Congress Party leader Rahul Gandhi, is fighting to keep his seat in parliament. To talk more about the elections, we're joined now by award-winning Indian author and journalist Siddhartha Deb. He wrote a widely discussed piece in The New Republic in 2016 headlined, "Unmasking Modi, the violence, insecurity and rage behind the man who has replaced Gandhi as the face of India." His nonfiction book, The Beautiful and the Damned, A Portrait of the New India, was a finalist for the Orwell Prize and the winner of the Penn Open Award. He's also the author of two books of fiction. Welcome back to Democracy Now!, Siddhartha. It's great to have you with us. Talk about the significance of these elections and who Narendra Modi is.
Well, thank you for having me here. It's great to be back 5 years later. Not so great in terms of the elections. India loses again, and the world loses with it. I think the scale of the victory is surprising, and it's an absolute majority for a leader who is seen as incredibly authoritarian, right-wing, majoritarian violence. And I think the difference between Modi's previous victory in 2014 and now was that in 2014 there was a semblance of talk about economic development, economic growth. 5 years of Modi at the helm have not delivered that in any way. India is a shambles at every possible way, and yet the Indian majority have voted for Modi again, and clearly not based on growth or economic development, but on majoritarianism and the promise of more violence.
Well, what's interesting, Siddhartha, is when we were speaking earlier, you, unlike many critics of the BJP and the Modi government, you actually anticipated that he would win.
I did, and it is depressing. It's depressing to have to say this, but, you know, one of the things is that, again, what I've seen over the last 5 years in India is that although the distress, the breakdown, the degradation is incredible. Economically, India is a shambles. The move that Modi introduced, something called demonetization, where just a majority of banknotes, small denomination banknotes that are used by large sections of the Indian population for everyday transactions. People who work as day laborers, this is how they earn money. They don't use credit cards. He canceled this without any kind of major public announcement. It created enormous distress. It's never happened in the history of Indian democracy that banknotes are suddenly non-functional. But in spite of this distress, in spite of the massive growth in unemployment, in spite of the farmers, the destitution, which has led to incredible marches by farmers into major cities like Mumbai and Delhi, with bones of farmers who have killed themselves. We are talking about that kind of deprivation. In spite of that, in Modi's growth on the Indian middle class remains solid.
And that is shocking because it's not based on infrastructure anymore. And it has to do with a kind of identification with this project of Hindu majoritarianism as the answer to whatever is complicated or confusing about the world today.
I mean, that's something that's extraordinary because the majority, you know, which people don't necessarily know about, the majority of India's population is still rural, 66%.
Yes.
So, and you've just talked about the conditions in rural areas.
Yes.
So how is it that those very same people, obviously in large numbers, still voted for Modi?
It's true. Well, I think one of the interesting things is in terms of the patterns is that the only little bit of hope that we see is that the South has still held out, has resisted this sort of, you know, wave of Modi. But the North and the West, which are more conservative, which are more ridden by caste, which are more ridden by sectarian identity, which are also more unequal in terms of wealth, which are split between vast impoverished majorities and a very tiny section elite, which is incredibly wealthy. So there, Modi's hold remains solid. He's further managed to expand into the East and the Northeast, which I find particularly distressing because that's where I'm from. Well, in Bengal, the disappearance of the left or the sort of the decline of the left has clearly allowed the rise of the BJP. But in Bengal and in Assam and in northeastern states, he's done it by raising the specter of migration from Bangladesh. This is, of course, connected to the fact of climate change, of, you know, increasing impoverishment, the decline of agriculture in entire South Asia across borders. But Modi has managed to turn this into a question of Hindus versus Muslims. And for him, it's synonymous with Indians versus outsiders, because for Modi, if you are a Muslim and to a lesser extent, if you're other minorities, if you're Christians, but particularly if you're Muslim, you are just not India. And this is true of Modi. This is true of the political party he represents, the BJP, and this is true of the paramilitary organization for which the BJP is a political front, which is the RSS, which is a right-wing fascist paramilitary organization dating back from the 1920s, and that takes its inspiration from Mussolini and the Nazis. Mm.
And of course, Narendra Modi himself, his history as he rose to power as the head, a kind of equivalent of governor of Gujarat, responsible for a massacre of
yes.
Muslims.
Yes. In fact, what people have been saying that this is a referendum on Modi. We've already had the referendum on Modi. We keep having referendums on Modi, you know. Modi was the chief minister of Gujarat in 2002. Under his rule, a pogrom against Muslims was instigated, which led to mass deaths, sexual violence, displacement of people into camps. Modi famously referred to them as baby-producing factories. This is the kind of person we are talking about. The United States, in 2002, banned Modi from entering the
United States. This was under George W. Bush.
Under George W. Bush. But
banned him from entering the United States for
years. He was denied a visa under the act of, you know, basically against working against religious freedom, against the principle of religious freedom. But Modi has successfully remade himself. He's turned himself into a strong man, and he's admired in India among the elite, but he's also admired in the West. So Modi's, although in Gujarat, when the riots happened, all the people who were punished got away pretty much scot-free. Those few people among bureaucrats, police officials, activists who managed to stand up were harassed and punished throughout. This is a clear pattern, and that is what Modi has taken across to India. But he's been embraced by the rest of the world. He's been embraced by the Obama administration. He was named by Obama as a Time Magazine Person of the Year. He was invited to the United States to address the Joint Houses of Congress. And even before the election results were declared completed in India yesterday, I believe last night there was an op-ed in the New York Times by a former Treasury Secretary of the Obama administration talking about how India needs Modi. And so, yes, he does have support across the world for this kind of violent majoritarian authoritarianism.
Well, I want to ask about another issue that's been crucial in this election and which many observers say has been critical to his victory. Corporations reportedly contributed as much as 12 times more money to the BJP than then to those of the other six national parties combined, amounting to 93% of all corporate donations. Recent changes in campaign finance laws also allowed companies to conceal how much they donated and to which party. Earlier this month, we spoke to award-winning Indian author Arundhati Roy. We asked her about the role of money in these elections.
I mean, if you look at now you have to be a rich person to stand for elections. You know, you have to have a lot of money. And, of course, the corporate, the corporate support would mean that, you know, there are certain corporations like Reliance, which is the biggest one in India, which owns, let's say, 27, 24-hour news channels or 27 TV channels, sorry. Now, so the combination of money, of a complete control on the media, and what used to be a complete control on the social media, you know, which has now been shaken a little bit.
So that's Arundhati Roy on Democracy Now! In fact, we spoke to her just the day after you interviewed her at the historic Apollo Theater in Harlem. So if you could respond to what she said, both the distorted and overwhelming coverage of Modi in the media and how much money the BJP was able to raise.
Yes, I think in that sense, India is following a pattern that is, again, you can see in the United States that a democracy, substantive democracy, does not really exist, even in countries where you have, no matter how impressive these elections might sound, because of the kind of distorting influence of wealth. Yes, the corporations have been behind Modi for a long time. This happened right after the Gujarat massacres in 2002, when some of them initially felt a little bit, I think, hesitant about just the scale and of the brutality of the violence. But they caved in. Modi was very, very strong. Modi took them on. They caved in. The Indian Chamber of Commerce sent him a letter of apology saying, "We are sorry that we hurt your feelings," because this is a man who cares deeply about his feelings, clearly. So yes, the Indian corporations, because the Indian corporations are being enriched at enormous rates. Now, India, again, as I said, it's a basket case economically, but there is massive wealth extraction going on in terms of natural resources. Companies like Reliance, another company called Adani, which is very, very close to Modi. So there is a kind of incredible crony capitalism that is present in India. There is a kind of, enrichment that is happening at the same time as the impoverishment of the masses. The corporations pretty much, and I worked in India as a journalist from the mid-90s, mainstream media in India, television is completely, I think Arundhati Roy famously called them Fox News on acid, which is a great phrase. But that is what Indian television is. It is unwatchable because it is an unending wave of violence and denunciation, again, against Dalits, against Muslims, against leftists, against feminist. It's this incredible, it's a kind of 24-hour rage. This is what the corporations produce. The same thing's true of the print media. Social media is a torrent of abuse as well. So yes, the media plays, and this answers another question that Nermeen asked earlier about the villages. Why are people doing it? They are manipulated by the electronic media, by the print media. It's very, the outreach is very, very successful. And so media does manage to spin the issue so that they don't think about the questions of employment or impoverishment.
We don't have much time, Siddhartha, but I did want to ask you about Narendra Modi, the past and now new prime minister's relationship with Trump, the United States, with Putin, Russia, with Netanyahu, Israel.
Oh, they all love each other. They are all authoritarians. They are all majoritarians. So in the way that Trump stands for white supremacy in the United States, Narendra Modi very much has a version of that in India, which is about Hindu majoritarianism. This is connected. All this is connected to climate change, to the growing impoverishment. We are basically, this is the result of decades of neoliberalism. And I have to say, there is no difference as far as I, as an Indian, am concerned. There's no difference between the Obama administration and the Trump administration. There's no difference between the Democrats and the Republicans as far as embracing Modi and this kind of majoritarian violence is concerned.
And again, the kind of inequality you're talking about in India, the Oxfam report that came out said the 9 richest individuals in India have as much wealth as the bottom 50%. That's the 9 richest individuals in India have the same amount as wealth of over 600 million Indians.
Yes, that is not a democracy. It's an oligarchy. It's a nation state held hostage by an oligarchy, and Modi is the strongman who is delivering them their riches.
Siddhartha Deb, we want to thank you so much for being with us, award-winning Indian author and journalist. We will link to that piece you wrote in The New Republic, headlined Unmasking Modi, the Violence, Insecurity and Rage Behind the Man Who's Replaced Gandhi as the Face of India, his nonfiction book, The Beautiful and the Damned, A Portrait of the New India. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. When we come back, Syria. Stay with us. Road to Nowhere by Anushka Shankar, the daughter of Ravi Shankar. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
We turn now to Syria. The State Department said Tuesday that the Syrian government may have used chemical weapons during recent fighting in Idlib. The State Department warned that the United States and its allies would respond quickly and appropriately if it's determined that chemical weapons have been used. This all comes as new questions are being raised about an alleged chemical weapons attack in the city of Duma last year. The Syrian government was accused of dropping 2 gas cylinders on the city, killing dozens of people. The U.S. and allies responded by carrying out airstrikes. But a newly leaked internal document from the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons reveals there were conflicting views within the organization as to what happened. The leaked document suggests the cylinders were manually placed on the ground and were not dropped from the air.
This has led some observers to conclude that the chemical attack might have been staged by Syrian rebels. The leaked document appears to contradict the official OPCW findings on what happened in Duma. In its official report, the organization said it had found, quote, reasonable grounds that the use of a toxic chemical as a weapon has taken place on April 7, 2018. We go to London right now, where we're joined by journalist Brian Whitaker, who's been closely following the story, former Middle East editor at The Guardian, now runs the website albab.com, which covers Arab politics and society. Brian, thanks for joining us. Talk about the significance of the document that has surfaced, who wrote that document, and what it means for the conclusions of the organization for the OPCW.
Yes, well, back in March, the OPCW's official fact-finding mission published its report, which, as you said earlier, was the one that suggested the chemical—the cylinders had been dropped from the sky, and that implied the regime was responsible. Now, what we had last week was a document written by a man called Ian Henderson, who, as far as I understand it, was working for the OPCW. He had some involvement with the fact-finding mission, but according to the OPCW, he wasn't actually a member of it. Now, it appears that at some point, probably late last year, he was allowed by the OPCW to do some work, basically to carry out his own assessment of what he thought might have happened. And he had some assistance, again, it's not very clear how much, from a group called the Engineering Subteam. So this document was then leaked last week. It was written, what we have that was leaked was a final, it's marked final draft. and this data, February the 27th, which, interestingly, was just 2 days before the official report was published. We don't know exactly what status this document has. One thing that some people say is that once the data had all been gathered from the Duma investigation, there were internal discussions and assessments within the OPCW to draw a sort of collective view of what had happened. And it may be that Mr. Henderson's document was part of that, although he was taking a very different view of the situation from the one that appeared in the report eventually.
Well, Brian, could you respond to what some observers have inferred from this document, namely that the chemical weapons attack in Duma last year may have been staged by the rebels? Has there been any precedent for that kind of staging by the rebels anywhere in Syria? And can this reasonably be inferred from that document, the leaked document?
Well, first of all, the first really serious chemical attack in Syria was in 2013, and that involved sarin in Ghouta on the outskirts of Damascus. Now, at that point, the Russians and various supporters of the Syrian regime started claiming false flags, you know, that the rebels were pretending to carry out chemical attacks and blaming the regime. What we have in connection with this latest one is that the fact-finding mission called on a number of international experts. They said there were three different expert analyses done by three teams in three different countries and that they worked independently. And the purpose of this exercise really was to examine the cylinders, look at the damage on them, look at the surrounding damage to the concrete roofs, and try to draw some conclusions about how the cylinders arrived there with complicated calculations like how fast it would be falling if it was dropped from the sky, and doing computer simulations and things like that. So it's a very technical sort of business. Now, Mr. Henderson's report seems to have done something similar. There's not very much detail about how he did it, but it seems that he contacted a couple of universities who gave guidance on how to do computer modelling. And the report kind of implies that it was the modelling was done internally by Henderson and perhaps other people, but it's not absolutely clear.
Let me ask.
So it's a very technical area, so it's very difficult for outsiders to judge, particularly as neither the official report nor Mr. Henderson's goes into any real detail about how they arrived at their calculations.
So do you think the disagreement revealed in the OPCW report, the OPCW leaked Duma document, should impact the way we look at the new claims of a chemical attack in Idlib? You have the State Department saying they're going to respond swiftly. What about this?
Well, these claims are always around with every reported chemical attack, that is nothing new. What's the interesting thing about the attack that the State Department was talking about last Sunday, although the reports are very sketchy, what they said was that some chemical shells were used and that four rebel fighters were injured. Now, although chemical weapons are banned under the Chemical Weapons Convention, so that is a crime to use chemical weapons in that way, the fact that it only injured four people makes it rather difficult to justify any sort of swift and strong response from the United States, as the statement put it.
Right, quickly and appropriately, I think they said.
And also, Brian, I think
Go ahead. No, there were two statements. One came from the State Department, and the American ambassador at the UN said something a couple of days earlier. So there are two slightly different phrases, but the general idea is that it would be a strong and swift response.
And Brian, in your view, do you think the OPCW would suppress information for political reasons from its reports, this Duma report in particular? And second, what do you think explains the fact that very few media have covered this internal document at all, including your former The Guardian, where you worked for many years?
Well, first of all, I think it's rather a complicated story. What we don't really know, you know, the people who say, okay, this report came out, it's not referred to in the official report that was published by the OPCW. So the question is why? And some people obviously suspect there was some kind of political motive behind the omission. What we don't know is whether that's true or whether there were other reasons which could be much more simple, like some of the research done by the experts for the FFM, the fact-finding mission, actually refuted some of the evidence that Henderson's document produced. So we don't know really what went on behind the scenes. And unfortunately, the OPCW doesn't really want to say very much about it. I sent them some questions last week, and I know a number of other journalists did. And what we got was a statement just generally saying that they'd considered all the available information and that they were having an inquiry into how the document was leaked. So that doesn't really get us very far, I'm afraid.
Well, we want to thank you for being with us. Brian Whitaker, former Middle East editor for The Guardian, now runs the website albab.com, which covers our politics and society. We'll link to your piece, OPCW, and the leaked Duma document, What We Know So Far. Of course, OPCW stands for Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
Amnesty International is calling for the United States to pay reparations to survivors of the U.S.-led military coalition attack on Raqqa. A recent investigation by Amnesty International and Air Wars showed the U.S.-led coalition killed more than 1,600 civilians during the 2017 offensive to oust ISIS militants from the Syrian city. The coalition launched thousands of airstrikes and tens of thousands of artillery strikes on the city.
U.S. troops fired more artillery in Raqqa than anywhere since the Vietnam War. At the time, the United States claimed it was the, quote, most precise air campaign in history. To find out more, we go to Washington, D.C. to speak with Margaret Hwang. She's executive director of Amnesty International USA, just returned this week from a research trip to Raqqa, Syria. Thank you so much for being with us. Talk about what you found, Margaret.
Thanks, Amy. The situation in Raqqa is truly extraordinary. The level of destruction that we've seen that is on the ground today is unprecedented in many, many ways. More than 80% of the city has been destroyed by the U.S. strikes. And what's most compelling about Raqqa is that there was only one party in this conflict that had airstrikes and that used artillery, and that is the U.S. coalition. In many other conflict zones, it can be very difficult and time-consuming to determine which party was responsible for which aspects of destruction. But in Raqqa, it's pretty straightforward because only one side of the conflict had access to those munitions.
And Margaret, can you just describe, having just been there for a few days, what are living conditions in Raqqa like for people who remain in the city?
So it's been more than 18 months since the end of the fighting, and the city still looks like a conflict zone. There have been efforts to clean up the streets, but the streets are heavily damaged as well. And even driving and walking around the city can be quite difficult, certainly for people who have disabilities caused by the war. It's almost impossible for anyone in a wheelchair to move around the city. Many, many residents are still living in buildings that are half destroyed. We saw many, many places where a half of a building had fallen down. There were structural damage to the building, and yet families were still living on upper floors of those buildings because there's no other place to live. And I think one of the most striking findings for me was that we interviewed many women who had lost their families, lost their parents, their spouses, their children in the bombings by the U.S. coalition. And their situation is even more desperate because of the social norms in Raqqa. They cannot live on their own. Their families feel tremendous pressure because they're trying to encourage them to marry another person. And it's been incredibly difficult for those women to mourn their families and also to find a new life in a place where there's no access to jobs, there's no electricity, and the destruction is truly calamitous.
Let me turn to one of the women Amnesty International spoke to in Raqqa earlier this year, Ayat's entire family killed in the airstrike.
My children, my husband, my mother, my sister, my niece, my whole family. I've lost them all, my dearest ones. We were sitting in the basement when the rocket hit just before sunset. When it hit my face, was burnt by the flames. My neighbor was in front of me and was left totally charred. When I came around, my son was screaming. He was in pain, but I couldn't help him. He was screaming, "Mommy, help me." I told him, "I can't, my son. I can't help you." I was burnt. I couldn't do anything. I couldn't move my hands or feet. I wasn't able to help him. He suffered until morning and then died. Those who can't afford the missiles that kill children can afford to help. What was this war? Wasn't the goal to free civilians? They were supposed to save us, to protect our children.
So, Margaret, you also met with Ayat when you were in Raqqa. Can you talk about what reparations would look like and what exactly you're calling for the U.S. and the U.K. to do right now in terms of rebuilding the city?
So there's no question that individual reparations are really, really important, particularly for women like Ayat. We did meet with her while we were in Raqqa. She is incredibly depressed. I think one of the forms of reparations is really recognizing the trauma that many of the survivors in the city have gone through, the numbers of their family that they've lost, and the sense of desperation that they feel about the future. But certainly a clean place to live, not a building that is half destroyed, is one piece. I think financial wherewithal, opportunities for work that would enable women and men to be able to provide for their families and to live in safety and security. And then, of course, just the infrastructure and the services in the city. There's really nothing in Raqqa right now to help rebuild. There's not equipment. There are not the resources. All of the schools in Raqqa have been destroyed. Many of the hospitals have been destroyed. The National Hospital has just reopened this spring, after a year and a half after the falling of the Islamic State forces. So there's no question that there are many services and infrastructures, roads, buildings that need to be restored so that everyone in the community can, in fact, return to a more secure and safe life.
And, Margaret, have you received any response from the U.S. or the U.K. governments to your requests or your demands that they should be involved in reconstruction and also reparations should be paid to the survivors?
When we first presented some initial findings and cases to the U.S. coalition, actually during the war, we were told that these were anomalies and not, you know, isolated cases and incidents. That is why Amnesty felt encouraged to do this very in-depth investigation. And we've now determined, at a minimum, a conservative estimate of 1,600 civilians killed. We've been presenting our cases to the U.S. coalition, asking them to acknowledge them and to move forward with some form of restitution and reparations. To this date, the U.S. military has acknowledged 180 of our cases that we've identified. They have not yet started with any restitution or reparation, and there are hundreds more that we're waiting for them to acknowledge. I think what's very clear on the ground is that it wasn't isolated cases. There were hundreds and hundreds of buildings destroyed and hundreds of families lost. And I think it's in the best interest of the U.S. military, the U.K. military, and other members of the coalition to really learn from this experience in Raqqa. If they believe in their precision airstrikes as a tool for trying to protect civilians, they need to understand what actual impact happened in Raqqa, who was affected, And if they're not willing to do the investigations themselves, then they have to take the cases and the incidences that we've provided and others in order to determine how they can offer better restitution to families.
Margaret Hwang, we want to thank you very much for being with us. Executive Director of Amnesty International USA just returned from a trip to Raqqa in Syria. We want to wish Mike DeFilippo a happy birthday. Democracy Now! Is produced by Mike Burke, Dina Guzder, Carla Wills. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh. Thanks for joining us.